Chemists have just discovered a ridiculous reagent that combines several reactions which students often hear about in their classes. It's just a bit crazy. Even if you're an expert, you will likely not know about all the insights we will cover today, so this video will expand everyone's horizon. Let's first briefly recap some basic knowledge before going into the fascinating synthesis, structure, and reactivity of this molecule. You've probably heard of Wittig reagents, also known as phosphonium-ylides, which have a negatively charged carbon sitting next to positively charged phosphorus. These structures can be formed by deprotonation because there is a stabilizing resonance form with a double bond between the two atoms, also called a phosphorane. The electrons, primarily localized on carbon, are clearly nucleophilic, so they can react with carbonyls to form four-membered ring intermediates, either through a 2+2 or stepwise addition. The phosphorus usually likes to buzz off in exchange for a stable PO double bond. Ultimately, this transfers the carbon to our molecule of interest through an olefination reaction. A related reaction is the Seyferth-Gilbert homologation, usually seen with aromatic carbonyls. Unlike the Wittig reaction, this one uses phosphonate reagents, which have phosphorus in a higher oxidation state. In addition, there's a diazo group to spice things up. The deprotonated reagent attacks our carbonyl in Wittig fashion, creating a new C-C bond and subsequently kicking out the phosphorus by creating a new PO double bond again. The diazo group in the product is an excellent leaving group and thus labile, forming very stable nitrogen gas. This is so energetically awesome that the carbon is left with an electron lone pair. This is a carbene because it has just 6 valence electrons instead of the 8 desired ones. Thus, it's pretty reactive and can rearrange to the alkyne. The ease of this rearrangement depends on how likely the substituents can undergo a 1-2 migration. This is easiest for hydrogen or aryl rests, which have a lower energy barrier compared to alkyl rests. To draw the parallel to the Wittig reaction, we're again adding one carbon, but instead of appending a chain through an olefin, the transferred carbon is sandwiched between the two pre-existing substituents in the alkyne. As a side note, you will more commonly see the Ohira-Bestmann modification of this reaction, which has a ketone attached to the alpha carbon. This is a milder way of getting to the same anion. Instead of adding a strong base that might wreck other parts of our molecule, methanol and a weaker carbonate base leads to the active species after initial nucleophilic attack of methoxide. A group of chemists has recently upped the ante. What happens if we take triphenylphosphine and nitrogen as very labile groups and attach both to the same carbon? Which group will eliminate and which will stay? To answer this, we first of all have to make the molecule. This is much simpler but simultaneously more interesting than you would expect. First up, you create something that resembles a double Wittig reagent by throwing two equivalents of triphenylphosphine at dibromomethane. As usual, strong base deprotonates the acidified position and gives the stabilized diphosphorane or bis-ylide. This molecule has been known since the 1960s and is indefinitely stable under an argon atmosphere, but it looks kinda crazy, doesn't it? Just like a Wittig reagent has an ylide resonance structure, this one is kinda like an ylide squared, also called a carbone. The formal oxidation state of carbon is zero, with all four valence electrons in the unbonded electron pairs, forming two negative charges. In some strange sense, this can even be described as two phosphine ligands donating electron density to a carbon zero atom, like in a metal complex. Keep this in mind as we will get into more funny structures later. So to get to our desired product with two different labile groups, we have to swap out one of the triphenylphosphines for a diazo group. This time the reagent is N2O. Can you guess the mechanism of this reaction? The first challenge is correctly drawing nitrous oxide, but once we do, we realize this is a reactive dipolar species that conveniently brings the N2 group as well as the oxygen atom that already has its eyes on the phosphorus. A first 3+2 cyclic addition creates a 5-membered ring intermediate, forming a PO single bond. The ring can fragment in a retro 3+2 fashion to kick out triphenylphosphine oxide with the PO double bond, giving us our exotic product. Here's the recipe for this step. Never mind the blast shield to minimize damage from potential exploding glassware. But wait a moment, there's also a second experimental procedure that includes this step and the previous. Can you spot the difference? Pause the video and take a close look at the reagents and conditions. Did you find it? Procedure 1 has the starting material that we just covered with two triphenylphosphine groups requiring heating in THF to proceed. The starting material on the right is not symmetrical as one of the groups is a tributyl phosphine instead. This reaction proceeds without any heating, suggesting a lower energy is required. Computational studies revealed that the transition state of the rate determining step, the initial 3 plus 2 addition, is almost 5 kilocalories per mole lower in energy. The authors suggest that because the central carbon has a higher electron density for butyl versus phenyl, it is more reactive for the nucleophilic attack to N2O. This not only explains the milder conditions, but also is a nice example of the superior importance of the rate determining step. The blue energy levels for other mechanistic steps are actually higher for N-butyl, but because they are much lower than the highest energy barrier, they don't matter. We can also nicely see the large energy dip after release of the phosphine oxide. Even though the second synthesis allowed better purification from the phosphine oxide byproduct, the chemists also used the first approach with the symmetrical educt and even scaled it to multiple grams. Recrystallization of the product from toluene at room temperature gave single crystals suitable for X-ray analysis. If you're a total noob, you should first of all note that the phosphorus is not planar but tetrahedral, with the phenyl groups oriented in a way that minimizes steric interactions. The heterocumulonic structure is not fully linear, but rather bent at carbon with an angle between P, C and N of roughly 120 degrees. As a side note, this is significantly more bent than the precursor diphosphorane that we saw earlier, which has an angle between P, C and P of 140 degrees. Various advanced methods of orbital and charge analysis support the notion that the primary resonance form is the carbone with two lone pairs on carbon. One lone pair has a sigma symmetry and the higher energy one, sitting in the homo, has more of a pi character. The authors didn't comment, but this makes carbones excellent donors that can coordinate up to two transition metals at once. For the precursor diphosphorane compound, interesting structures like this dinuclear gold complex are known. Beyond the cumulonic and carbon forms, other resonance structures also exist due to the interplay of the N2 group. The bottom one looks particularly crazy, but also had a significant theoretical contribution in the chemists' calculations. This is an extreme way of showing the conjugation of the carbon's two electron pairs with the two pi star orbitals of the NN triple bond. We mentioned the precursor diphosphorane is pretty stable, but what about this one? These thermogravimetric curves show the mass remaining throughout continuous heating. Our trusted friend, the Ohira-Bestmann reagent, decomposes at around 100 degrees Celsius already, even though you might think it's more stabilized. In contrast, our Diazo-Ylide is pretty comfortable up until 190 with relatively controlled loss of N2. You know who else is pretty comfortable? I am, knowing that there are great folks out there supporting my work. Thanks to all the channel members and thank you for watching. So how does this molecule react? The answer is everyone's favorite. It depends. Reminding ourselves of the dative form again, we can see that this is a carbon zero that is stabilized by triphenylphosphine and nitrogen. Our first type of reaction out of three might be the simplest. What do you think is the product after exposure to an atmosphere of carbon monoxide? Here, N2 was simply exchanged for CO. This is likely another dipolar addition and fragmentation sequence, similar to what we've seen in the synthesis of the reagent itself. Because the central carbone is inherently nucleophilic, drawing the reaction with the unstabilized carbene resonance structure of CO seemed most logical to me. Overall, N2 leaves as one of the two labile groups. The same was observed in reactions with isocyanides or other stabilized carbenes. So our reagent transferred the phosphorylid group, making it useful for synthesis of complex aldene structures. By the way, these reactions could not be replicated by using the product obtained after N2 to CO exchange. Thus, the N2 group in a reagent is critical for success. But does that mean the N2 group always disappears? Try to explain the multi-step reaction of our reagent with this alkene. Our product is aromatic and is formed regioselectively. Due to the carbonyl substituent, the alkene is quite electron deficient, so the nucleophilic carbon of our reagent adds to the electrophilic beta carbon. To explain the next steps and our product, we need to have a proton shift, moving the negative charge from the ylide to the stabilized alpha position. As the acyl chloride reagent is an electrophile again, it's attacked by the nitrogen. You might have assumed the other regioselectivity with the negative charge of the carbon ylide assisting acylation of the other nitrogen. Turns out that's not how it works, sorry. Finally, sodium hydride is added, so a strong base. We could of course regenerate the ylide form again, but elimination of triphenylphosphine gives the very stable aromatic product. Our beloved Ohira-Bestmann reagent could undergo a similar reaction, but this final step, elimination of the phosphonyl group, is impossible in that case, because it's not a reasonable leaving group. This again makes our reagent somewhat unique. But remember that the olefin should be electron deficient and thus a good electrophile to enable the first step. What happens if we expose the reagent to another electrophile, this time an aldehyde? Our first example with benzaldehyde is really straightforward. The Wittig-like olefination gives a diazoalkane, which releases nitrogen, creating the unstable carbene intermediate. The formation of the alkyne comes from a 1-2 hydride shift, as opposed to migration of the phenyl group. This simple reaction can be achieved with the Ohira-Bestmann reagent. Fair enough. But our exotic reagent can do things which it can't. It's already convenient that our diazo-ylide is more thermally stable and also does not need addition of base because it's already in its ylide form. This is handy for substrates where strong base might start taking other groups in our molecule apart. But the Ohira-Bestmann reagent also requires protic solvents such as methanol, which narrow our scope. If you attempt the reaction with cinnamaldehyde, you will not get the conjugated alkyne product, but rather see this side product arising from conjugate addition of methanol. In contrast, the reaction with our freaky reagent was conducted in benzene, giving the desired product. The aldehyde is likely so electrophilic that the homologation is much faster than conjugate or cycloaddition. The opposite was seen for amides and esters, which didn't react at all. Even at 100 degrees, which the reagent can nicely withstand due to its high thermal stability. The electron density at these carbonyl carbons is simply too high, preventing initial nucleophilic attack. Let's wrap up with a final set of reactions. Adding cyclohexanone to an excess of the reagent gave cumulenic 1,2,3 triene. This process is different because in the vinylidene carbene intermediate, there is no hydrogen available for the rapid 1,2 shift. If any of the alkyl rests would migrate, we would form an extremely strained alkyne. Instead, dimerization seems more favored. This starts to change once we increase the conformational flexibility of the cyclic ketone. Repeating the reaction with cyclododecanone at a high temperature of 90 degrees led to 48% of dimer, but also 37% of the alkyne. Intriguingly, the dimerization is still more favored than intramolecular 1,2 migration, even though the resulting alkyne is not really strained anymore. This once again shows that the migratory tendency of alkyl groups in these reactions is rather low. We can close the loop by looking at the reaction with benzosuberone, which gave the following product. Can you figure out how this works? Now, the aryl rest can migrate more readily, giving the strained cyclic alkyne as a first intermediate. It has a low energy LUMO, so it can undergo a dipolar cycloaddition, just like we've seen numerous times today already. 76% yield for such a strange ylide is not too shabby. It might be pretty useful for someone in the future. This has to be one of the most versatile reagents ever. We've seen it can transfer the phosphor ylide part, giving rise to Wittig reagents, the carbon diazo group in cycloadditions, but also single carbons or even a combination of all of these. Did you learn something new today? I sure hope so, and would be thrilled if you join us again in our next video. Thanks for watching and supporting the channel. Until next time.